Let's now take a look at the papers this morning on Off the Press and say hello to our guest, Mr. Tunde Kolawole. Good morning. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning, my sister. Hope you had a great weekend.
Fantastic. Thank you. Let's begin with the Punch newspaper this morning. The headline reads, High Commission Infections. Buhari, Asorok aides take COVID-19 test after UK trip. It goes on to say that according to a Villa official, presidential aides are agitated following positive cases in Nigeria's High Commission. Also, coronavirus cases hit 8,054 in 2 weeks. Second phase of vaccination begins today with Moderna. Foreign reserves resume decline after rising to $33.59 billion. Nigeria recorded $85.21 billion net foreign liabilities, according to the IMF. Health sector strike looms. Johessud threatens action over allowances, and health workers say that they are sensitive to the earnings of Nigerians, but strike is an option. Also on the Punch, Afghan president flees Kabul as Taliban takes over presidential palace. JAM VCs others meet on UTME cutoff max on August 31st. We see more headlines on the Punch newspaper saying Prophet tackles Okotie over attack on late TB Joshua. Buni APC leaders meet Ladoja over party fortune. NDLEA nabs Italy-bound woman concealing 100 wraps of cocaine in her relaxer. Also on the Punch newspaper, freed ex-firma engineer dies day after 4.5 million naira payment to kidnappers. Two more stories on the Punch. Outrage trails Plateau killings. NSCIA, CAN reacts as tension rise. Lastly, Oyetola Aribishola supporters in verbal war over Secretariat's invasion.
All right, and now on the Daily Sun. Catholic bishops brand Nigeria world's most terrorized nation. Claim situation not different from civil war. Anarchy looms, GNI warns. PDP chair says APC has begun rigging of 2023 polls. Sit at home, Kanu's family denies interference in IPOB's affairs. And NDLEA nabs Italy-bound woman with 100 wraps of heroin at Lagos airport. Outrage over Joss killings. Governor Lalong imposes 24 hours curfew. NGF calls incidents horrible and senseless. And Catholic bishops tackle northern governors. UK trip, Buhari and others in quarantine, says the presidency. And also PDP, Southwest renews quest for chairmanship. Otedola reveals how IBB advised Jonathan to assume Yaradua's duty before doctrine of necessity. And finally, Oluwawori, squabble over secession normal in kingdom, says the prince.
Let's take a look at the Daily Independent newspaper now. Headline reads, banks reap big despite floundering economy. While over 40 million SMEs groan for lack of access to credit, and analysts say they have abandoned financial intermediation. PDP crisis. Secundus, National Working Committee members agreed not to seek re-election. That's according to Dopasi. Why convention may not hold in October. Tollgate, stop imposing more hardship on Nigerians, PDP tells APC. Afghanistan government collapses. President flees. Taliban enters Kabul. Otedola recounts how IBB asked Jonathan to sit on Riyajo's chair. Plateau killings. 20 suspects arrested. 33 victims rescued. Police deployed team. Lalong imposes 24-hour curfew on Jos North. Some more stories on the Daily Independent. 17 billion naira tax evasion. Senate charges FIRS to go after the 14 agencies. COVID-19. Presidency confirms Buhari under quarantine after UK trip. Governor Zulum says Borno in dilemma over repentant insurgents. 724 dead in Haiti earthquake as death toll climbs.
And on the Nigerian Tribune, Taliban forces take over Afghanistan as president flees. VAT as weapon in battle for resource control. And also 2023 presidency, Buhari's associates search for southern legacy candidate. PDP looks up north. Seven female minister may emerge APC VP candidate. Also, Plateau death toll rises to 32. Government declares curfew. 20 suspects arrested, 31 victims rescued. UNIJOS suspends second semester examinations, and also IGP deploys intervention team to restore sanity. 2023, Buni Bagudu, Badaru Bankole meet Ladoja in Ibadan. And also Army, 21 Army recruits die in auto crash in Jigawa. INEC stoppage of e-voting machine purchase, a ploy to rig elections, says Secundus. We can also find on the Nigerian Tribune, recover missing 17 billion naira tax within 90 days. Senate orders FIRS.
All right, I think those are the stories we're looking at this morning on Off the Press. Let's now begin to see exactly what, you know, the meaning is beyond the headlines. Mr. Kolawole, I want us to begin with what's happening in Plateau State in, you know, just south and just north. Over 20 people have been killed by, you know, herdsmen in that part of the country. The government says about 20 suspects have been arrested. And all these killings really came after the governor, Simon Lalong, imposed a 24-hour curfew in the state. It's been a while we saw something like this happen in Plateau regarding the Fulani travelers being killed, and especially the attack on that UniJOS student, leading to, you know, the shutdown of the school right now. What can you tell us about what the government, you know, seemed to be failing to do years and years after these security threats emerged?
Honestly speaking, there is no sane person that will read the story that is coming from Jos this morning and will not weep for Nigeria. I feel personally touched by these senseless killings. But the truth of the matter is that Jos has always been a restive place. Yes, before now, we have had some calm in that part of the country, but it didn't mean that those who are set on set, who are bent on setting the country, I mean the country on fire, have seated their sword. There are two or three issues, fundamental issues in Jos. Jos has always been a home to a branch or a sect of Islamic fundamentalists who are very powerful and who have also not who are not too much different from the Boko Haram sect and ISWAP. They have also never hidden their intention to Islamize Nigeria. The second issue is like any other, or most other cosmopolitan cities in Nigeria. It used to be like Lagos, it used to be like Port Harcourt, in which you find different people from different parts of the country inhabiting that beautiful city in a very peaceful and quiet manner. Check out some of our musicians, check out some of our sportsmen, footballers, and what have you. Most of them who are either Igbo, Yoruba, Hausa, or Fulani, whatever, they were all born and brought up in church without any issues. But since the Islamic fundamentalists have taken grip of Jos, and certain persons have been claiming that just belongs to one section of the country or the other. You have the Biron claiming Jos, you have some TV claiming Jos, you have some Afulani also claiming Jos, you have some Fulani claiming Jos. Since all these ugly incidents began to rear their heads, there has never been peace again in Jos. Well, the truth of the matter is that the government is still to blame. By now, we have had about 10 or 12 years of this insurgency. That is quite enough time to unravel those who may be behind all this wanton and senseless killing that we have seen in the country. If the government has been not proactive and have approached the issues in the plateau, in the middle belt, with the clinical efficiency with which they have tackled the issue of IPOP and that of the Yoruba Self-Determination Group, I'm sure it would have seen some headway in the middle belt and in Jos in particular. Mm. But it would appear to me it is carrot for a certain section of the country where they apply stick, very heavy stick, to the other sections of the country. And when you have that uneven-handed approach to very, very serious problems, you will continue to have the kind of crisis that we have in church today. Let's lay the whole blame at the doorstep of President Muhammad Buhari and the APC government. These people have no right whatsoever to stay in power a day longer. I'm going to be harsh. And we needed to be harsh because even during the Civil War, we didn't experience this kind of this wanton killings. But because of incompetent leadership, lack of visionary leadership, and security chiefs who are coming from a section of the country who do not see that they hold the whole Nigerian people an equal approach to the tackling of security, should be blamed for this senseless and wanton killing that we see all over the place.
Well,
okay.
Of course, the reports from Johns, you know, also is detailing some sort of reprisal killings. You know, it feels like it's a response to the killing of about 20 people that are taking place days earlier. So it might be intercommunal clashes. It might be, you know, herders and farmers clashes. You know, there's still the need to seek clarity on what exactly is going on here. And that also includes in Southern Kaduna. You know, there's still reports over there. But before we come back to Nigeria, let's, you know, move to the international scene briefly and get your thoughts on the issues in Afghanistan. The president has fled the country. The Taliban are forming a new government over there. But, you know, you can also see thousands of people looking for ways to flee the country. It feels like, well, it's obvious that, you know, the security agencies have been broken down in just 2-3 weeks after the U.S. started pulling out troops. What are your thoughts on Afghanistan's current situation?
My brother, Nigeria is gradually approaching the level of what is happening in Afghanistan. And when you hear people talking about Plan B, they are probably envisaging that sooner than later, the rural bandits, the urban bandits, and some of these other bandits all over the country, the Islamic fundamentalists, Boko Haram, ISWAP, and all the rest of them, might overrun the country and seize control of power just as it happened in Afghanistan. Because simply put, you will find that the Islamic fundamentalists in Nigeria have also started infiltrating all faces of our life, all our cities, all our villages, all our forests, all our roads. They're gradually taking over. As soon as they settle in those places and all that, they will launch a ferocious bid for power. What happened in Afghanistan is simply that when the Americans took control of that place over about 20 years ago, when they were said to be pursuing Osama bin Laden, who had used the aeroplane to bring down some buildings and attack people in the U.S., they went in there, took over power, and then were reorganizing the so-called society and the Afghanistan army. But while they were doing that, the Taliban were the ones sending their soldiers, their people, to enlist in the Afghanistan army. 70% of the men and women you find in the Afghanistan army were Taliban who pretended they were patriots joining the government army in Afghanistan. So as soon as this offensive was launched, the soldiers should confront the Taliban, lay down their arms, turn down their weapons, high-grade weapons, and surrendered to the Taliban. And so the Taliban easily overran the whole of the country in less than 2 weeks. If care is not taken, Nigeria might experience that kind of a tragedy as well. So this is a lesson for us as a people. But even more fundamentally, this will be the second time the Taliban will be defeating a very strong army. The Soviet Union went into Afghanistan before, and the Taliban defeated them. The Soviet army, former USSR, they ran away from Afghanistan. The Americans too have run away now from Afghanistan with all the military expertise, with all the skills, with all the aeroplanes and everything that they have. Simply because war is not won by the weapons that you carry. War is won in the hearts of men. And when you have men who are not convinced of the cause for which they are fighting for, the possibilities are that they will hardly approach the war or do the part to fight the war the way it should be fought. These are some of the things we see with Islamic fundamentalists. And people who have the kind of conviction that they have, they fight with their heart, they fight with their mind, they fight with their brain, they fight with their brawn, and they put everything into it. So when you bring the best of weapons against them, it is hardly effective, it doesn't neutralize them. So I appeal to Nigerian youth, those who have the wherewithal to do it, to begin to take this Boko Haram insurgency thing, this Islamic fundamentalism that is on the rise in Nigeria, as a very, very serious matter. And the Western world should be warned that surrendering to the Taliban two times now is likely to put an end to Western civilization. Because immediately the Taliban settle down in Afghanistan, they will expand their base because they will not want to be isolated. They are already in link with the Pakistani, with Pakistan. And Iran is also close to Afghanistan. You and I also know that Iraq, Syria, and some of these other countries that have pretenses to Islamic fundamentalism are also close to Afghanistan. So the possibility that Afghanistan will return back as a base for Islamic expansionism, for the toppling of Western democracies and civilization is very, very high. That was why I have in the past said the whole world ought to afford disarming into Afghanistan, into Iran, and stamp out this crude, this barbaric, and these backward regimes that now want to turn the hand of the clock, that want to reverse all the gains that humanity has made in terms in the areas of science, in the area of culture, in the area of education, in the area of music, in every other area in sciences that humanity has achieved. The aim and goal of Islamic fundamentalism is to turn back the hands of the clock. Look at what is already happening. Women who used to work in Afghanistan, the Taliban have asked them to stay at home. Women who could dress the way they like, the Afghanistan is now insisting that they must wear a border. Children also who are girls can no longer go to school. Women cannot venture, they cannot go to market, they can't go to cinema, they can't go to sports playgrounds. These are the dangers of Islamic fundamentalism that is staring the world in the face. And other than the way we are facing up to this Islamic fundamentalism, most of them are considering very parochial interests. They are narrow national interests. They are not seeing the larger picture. That the aim of this Islamic fundamentalist is to reverse human civilization, is to take over the world, return to what used to happen before Western civilization became dominant all over the world. And come to think of it, immediately Western civilization goes, every gain, like I said, that humanity has achieved in the area of science will be imperiled.
All right, Mr. Kolawole, I want us to now juxtapose that what's happening in Afghanistan with what's happening in Nigeria. On the front page of the Daily Independent newspaper, we saw a story saying that Borno State right now is in a dilemma over repentant insurgents. And Governor Babagana Zulum, you know, I'm going to read a statement from him. He says that we in Borno State are in a very difficult situation over the ongoing surrender of insurgents. He went on to say that we have to choose between the endless wars or to cautiously accept surrender terrorists, which is difficult for anyone. Mr. Kolawole, do you really believe that we have these two options and that's all the options we have, to either continue the war against insurgency or to accept terrorists? Looking from, you know, looking at what happened in Afghanistan, we know that the person who is leading this operation in Afghanistan, the head of the Taliban right now, was one of the men that the United States, you know, forced the Taliban or asked the Taliban to release. So he was in prison a couple of years ago. He was released now, and he's now overrun the country. So looking at that and what's happening here in Nigeria, where we seem to have the attitude of embracing terrorists and, you know, saying that they have repented and reintegrating them into society, what really can you say about our own situation here in Nigeria?
Well, when you look at our own situation here in Nigeria, I haven't seen a clear-headed approach to really resolving this issue of Boko Haram ISWAP and the rise of Islamic fundamentalism in Nigeria.
Okay.
My preaching, my advocacy over the time has always been that if Nigeria is going to be able to overcome this Islamic fundamentalist rise, is for the whole entire country and the North in particular to subscribe to the secularism of the Nigerian state. They should do away with his Sharia law. We have to do away with ISPAC. We have to do away with a situation in which people want to drink alcohol cannot drink alcohol. We have to do away with the situation in which children cannot dress the way they don't like.
Mr. Kolawole, apologies to interrupt. Like, I really want to find out from you regarding this attitude of saying terrorists have repented and we are reintegrating them into society and that they can rise to any, you know, height of political ambition that they so desire. Should this be the way forward? Should Nigeria and the military be accepting terrorists?
I was going to come to that. You know, initially when I began my conversation on this, I said, look, we don't have a clear-headed approach to really resolving this Islamic fundamentalist challenge that we have in our hands. Ordinarily, how do you rehabilitate people you don't know, people you just give education for 1 or 2 months, and then you say they have been radicalized? That is not the way things are done. What you do is that when people surrender and say, look, we no more participating in this war, we want to, we become repentant. You do what you call profiling.
Okay.
After you have done the profiling of them, those who have no people's blood, who haven't killed anybody, or those who are underage, who are children, or those who are women, who did not voluntarily or willingly enlist into the Boko Haram and into the Iswap army, those ones you can de-radicalize. And after you have radicalized them, you find a way to rehabilitate them. But those who are taking weapons to kill people, those who have human blood in their hands, those who have been Islamic fundamentalists even before Boko Haram started its campaign.
But Mr. Kolawole,
how do you know the difference?
Exactly.
Mr. Kolawole, how do
you... You're not supposed to start rehabilitating such person. What you are supposed to do,
Mr. Kolawole,
is to arrest such persons in court for murder, for arson, for all manners of crime, drug trafficking.
Mr. Kolawole, Mr. Kolawole, I want to ask you this question. Should all terrorists not be treated the same? Because really, how do you pick and choose which ones were conscripted, which ones were forced into terrorism, and which ones, you know, originally and fundamentally believe that terrorism is the way forward? Mr. Kolawole, if you can hear me, I'm asking, should punishment for terrorism not be punishment for terrorism across board?
What? According to law, the punishment for terrorism in Nigeria today is, I think, life imprisonment, which is even more lenient compared to a crime for murder, compared to a crime to armed robbery, compared to a crime to even like, rape, compared to pipeline vandalization. And why the legislators have made this so, I really don't understand. I should think that this terrorism thing should carry capital punishment. Because in my humble opinion, it is worse than murder. It's usually wanton killings of people, mass murder. But as of today, what is in our statute book is that if people are convicted for terrorism, you go for life imprisonment. And so when you go to prison in Abuja, now to Kuje prison, and some of these other places where the Boko Haram people have been jailed, are serving their sentences and all that. Most of them are living like prince and princesses.
Mr. Kolawole, kindly hold on. Hold on, Tunde Kolawole. If you can hear us, kindly hold on. Because we need to move to something else. You know, but the question I think Aneta is asking is, how do you tell the difference between those who are, you know, terrorists and those who, like you said, were forced or coerced into terrorism? If they've all committed murder, if they've all killed hundreds and dozens of people, regardless of, you know, how they got into terrorism, you know, do you have a different sentence for, you know, for two different people? And how can the Nigerian army or the Nigerian security agencies tell the difference between...
Hello?
Can you hear me?
Can you repeat that, please? Can you repeat that?
All right, Mr. I think we can... let's quickly just move on to something else because of time.
All right.
Let's move to the story on the Tribune this morning that says 2023 presidency, Buhari's associate search for Southern legacy candidate. So the PDP looks up north, and seven female minister may merge APC VP candidates. Share your thoughts on that quickly before we wrap up.
Well, that has been the bane of Nigerian politics. When people are rounding up their terms or when they are leaving power, they will usually shop for people who they think that can cover their track who they think that will continue their legacies, no matter what those legacies are. Mm. It shouldn't be the responsibility of President Muhammad Buhari to begin to shop for people or for the president or the vice president or for any governor who will replace the outgoing ones. That should be left to the political parties and then to the Nigerian people. Because when you shop for a replacement for yourself and another, the possibilities are very high that you might be rigging the election in favor of that kind of a person. And so, Nigerian people should resist that. They should stand up to the APC and President Muhammadu Buhari. Let the electorate decide who is going to be president and vice president come 2023. For the PDP, I wish to appeal to them once again. Put their house in order. Nigerian people are disenchanted with what we have in our hands today. And if there is any credible alternative or a semblance of alternative to the APC, it probably will be the PDP. Because the time is rather too short now for anybody to say we'll form a pan-Nigerian political party to be able to take over power from the APC. The time will also be too short for them to raise the necessary funds to be able to challenge the APC. If there is any party that has the wherewithal, the experience, and then people who have the means to really give the APC a run for its money, it is the PDP. But lo and behold, you see what is happening. The PDP is collapsing. The APC is going around the country to poach for the most varied members of the PDP. And because most of those varied members also want to be in the winning team, they think that once they join the APC, all their sins are forgiven, no matter how heinous the crimes might be. Then most of them are flocking to the APC, the winner mentality. This doesn't all go well for the whole country. Because if the whole country collapses on our head, nobody will remember that either the APC or the PDP or whatever political party is in there. All of us should shop together. People should retain principle. People should have abiding faith. People should have, I mean, should be ready to work hard to rebuild whatever political platform that they find themselves on today. After all, it took only the APC a few years to reorganize, to reorganize, to couple together a legacy party that was able to wrestle power from the PDP.
All right, Mr. Kolawole.
The PDP can also do the same by going for some of these other fringe political parties and all that and bringing their men into the fold and then throwing their energy into it. Come up with a very, very good candidate, a nice, excellent economic rehabilitation program, and then go for the youth who have ideas.
All right. Tunde Kolawole, I think we can wrap up here. All right. Thank you very much, Mr. Kolawole. Thanks for your thoughts on a Monday morning.
Thank you, Mr. Kolawole. Thank you. Have a great day. All right. Really interesting stories there. Too bad we can't take all of them. But yes, what we'll do is take you back in time. And I'm going back to the 2018 fire season that occurred in a Canadian province. How about you?
I'm sharing about the fastest man in the world. In 2009, Usain Bolt.